I'm going to begin just by asking, I mean, so many superheroes seem to kind of resent their powers. A lot of the times it comes from quite dark places.
Yeah.
In this instance, he has so much fun and he loves having his powers. That must have been such a great and so much fun for you to play.
Oh, yeah, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, the wish fulfillment of this movie is like, there's so many layers of it. The movie itself, thematically, you have so much of that, like, you know, in the underpinnings. That's the child in all of us who gets that magic word and become a superhero. That speaks to, I really do believe, every single person in the world at some point, including myself when I was a kid, and still even now as an adult, wish that I had superpowers. So that was already making me super stoked and giddy and happy. Then the actor in me, who always wanted to portray his own, you know, titular superhero, bona fide superhero, that's happening. So that's making me even more happy and giddy. And the fact that I don't have to restrain any of that, but in fact, in actuality, you get to use it to fill Billy Batson with all of that fun and enthusiasm and childlike wonderment and all that, was just a ball. Like, as I was doing it, it was dawning on me that, oh man, what a cool gift that I've been given, that I get to have a fun superhero that's not feeling weighed down with the responsibilities of saving the world all the time and the drama that comes with that. And I just get to, you know, be a little footloose and fancy free and, you know, shoot lightning from my fingers and learn my powers. And what a gift, yeah.
Your character, though, he's a bit of a nasty bastard.
He is indeed. Heat-seeking ballistic evil, as I like to describe him.
I know, I mean, it's a real cliche. Everyone says, oh, it must be really fun to play those roles. But I was wondering more about the kind of cathartic side to playing a villain. Because we all have those, well, we're not all kind of evil within us, but we all have a kind of darker side to our demeanours or thoughts, perhaps, that aren't as nice. And this is a way to explore that on screen through the prism of a kind of another character. Do you find playing villainous roles to be mildly cathartic in that?
I do. That's a really good point, yeah. I mean, I think, with a lot of characters that you create, being able to put yourself in someone else's shoes and walk those shoes around for a bit and live that life for a bit means that when you come out of that, you've kind of had an experience that isn't usual. It's not normal. People don't normally do that. So to get to play a guy who is controlled and serious and driven and malevolent is a kind of, it's like having a sort of emotional holiday, if you like.
I'm going to begin just by asking about, I mean, the central kind of messages to this film. They're sort of so positive, and it really stood out the second time I saw it, more so than the first, is that the film really, above anything else, is a true celebration of the individual, the outsider, sort of, if you will, making kids who might not feel cool, feel cool. It must be great putting those messages in there in a movie like this, and knowing that through the prism of the kind of superhero genre, you're really preaching great positive stuff to the next generation.
Right. Yeah, and in all areas, like even with the, you know, the group home and the foster kids, you know, it's kind of a breath of fresh air to be able to show the happy foster family, you know, and not like, oh, the evil foster parents or the bad group home or anything like that. So it's, yeah, it has a lot of positivity in it.
And then the idea that each of us have a superhero within us, no matter who you are, what age you are, what your background is, the superhero is within you, and the question is just how do you access it.
I saw this video online, which was really sweet, which is this sort of young girl hugged you, I think it was at a screening.
It was in Brazil at a convention Brazil. Down there, yeah.
And she wouldn't let go, and I think you got quite sort of emotional in it. And I just realised, I mean, because obviously this is your first kind of big role of this nature.
Yeah.
Has it taken some getting used to? And it must be so amazing to know that you now mean a lot to loads of sort of children out there.
Yeah, man. I mean, none of that is lost on me. It is quite an honor, I think, when you are given the opportunity to bring roles to life in movies that deeply resonate with people, whether they're kids or adults or what have you. I'm grateful that I have been a part of some other projects through the years that have already given me, I think, a pretty good understanding of that responsibility. And I've always tried to wield it in the most responsible way possible. I think, you know, as celebrities, or, you know, fame comes with a platform and a privilege with that platform. And, you know, I've been, like, I did a TV show called Chuck years ago, and the Chuck fans to this day, I'll go to conventions, and there's quite a few breakdowns. There's quite a few people who have watched that show so much and have identified with the characters so much, or went through some really dark times and were able to come out the other side because of that. The fact that now I get to be a kid superhero that all of these kids can hopefully see themselves in, and that it's uplifting and about family and about finding family. I don't take any of that lightly. I think it's really quite a privilege, and I hope that I'll always I hope that I'll remain stalwart. I'm looking forward to every opportunity where I'm able to use that to make other people's lives better.
In some of your scenes where you have to display your true evil and your aggression, it's with a room full of kids. What are those scenes like to shoot? Because obviously, the protagonist obviously here, the hero, is Shazam, who's mixes between a 14-year-old boy and kind of an adult. So there are scenes where you're confronting a sort of child, but you still have to maintain that anger and that aggression. That must have been quite fun to play around with in some ways.
It was. It's kind of a mad notion that all that aggression is being directed at a 14-year-old. But also that, when I have them sitting on the sofa there, I didn't really play with them much because I wanted them to be a little bit terrified, because they saw me as, you know, Mark Strong, this English actor guy, the guy in the sunglasses and the black coat who's sort of wandering around in the background. So I tried to keep it like that as much as possible. And then when I had one up close scene with Jack, I literally grab him and shove him up against some lockers and everything. Jack describes it as in the moment he was terrified until the end of the scene when I went, "Are you all right? Is everything okay?" And I took great pains to make sure he wasn't scared.
And I love the kind of, obviously, so you can see the influences from Big in here. And I mean, recently I saw sort of Captain Marvel, which is entrenched in 90s nostalgia. And this feels like it's got a real sense of the kind of Goonies and films about it. And it seems to really starting to go back and kind of, and hark back to pop culture from the 80s and 90s. I mean, that must be quite fun to play around with in movies like this. But at the same time, is there ever a risk of alienating the younger viewer who might not quite get all the references, or are they just in there for us?
Well, to me, it was more about tapping into the feel and the spirit of the movies like from the 80s and like Amblin movies and things like that, rather than making, like, setting it in the 80s and or making a pastiche of 80s movies or something. And I think that core and that type of movie that had a little bit of everything, you know, has humor and heart and even sometimes a little bit of horror, you know, that's going to work with any audience, you know. There's not really any references to pick up on. It's just fun movie making, you know.
And how aware of other movies within this kind of wide, broader universe do you have to be? I mean, obviously when you have a film like this, which works incredibly well as a standalone film, it's still got so many kind of bits of connective tissue to other films in the DC universe. I was just wondering how much that plays on your mind when making this, how many times you actually have to think about where this fits into the broader kind of sort of context.
I mean, that was a great thing that we only had to focus on making a great Shazam movie, and there wasn't any sort of discussion of, oh, you have to set this thing up for down the road, or you have to include this, or you can't include this. The only mandate was make a great Shazam movie. And then, of course, we are fans of this world and of comic book movies and comic books. So we, you know, went to town with, like, oh, we can reference this, or we can have an Easter egg to that, and we can just, you know, make it really feel like it takes place in this world.
And if you're not familiar with this world at all, it doesn't matter. It's just a great standalone movie for, you know, if you've never read Shazam or any comic books, it's just a fun action comedy with a great wish fulfillment center at its core.
Just very quickly before I go, I've always thought, because I watched Big recently.
Yeah.
And it struck me just how incredible Tom Hanks' performance is. Because I think it's actually harder, because you've got to play a child in a man's body. And what was it like for you just quickly just playing that? And what do you miss most about being a child, about being 14 years old?
Well, fortunately for me, I have always resisted growing up. So I think that's probably how I got the job to begin with and helped me to slip into that a little bit easier. I was trying to remind myself the kids are silly. They're always silly because they don't have any responsibilities. They're not thinking about that. They're just thinking about how to make each other laugh and one-up each other and, you know, but also kind of dealing with, like, social pressures and want to be cool and all that jazz. So I was channeling a lot of that, but that was all just fun. And again, the wish fulfillment that I was already having, that made it a lot easier to do that and that I could show that. And then I can't remember what was the other part of the question, but as far as Big is concerned, yeah, man, that was a touchstone big time for us. Because this movie is basically Big meets Superman. And Tom Hanks has been an idol of mine since I was a kid. I've watched Big so many times. The interesting kind of difference between the two is that once Tom showed up, he just had to be, it was just Tom till the end of the movie. And then he became, you know, the kid again. In this, we go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. So that's a real credit to David Sandberg our director, and Asher, and you know, myself, I think all working in concert to make sure that all felt seamless, you know, or as seamless as possible.
Because, I mean, he's not really a very well-known villain in many regards, in a sense that I think, you know, I don't think anyone's played him before on screen. That must have given you quite a lot of license with this role, because, I mean, you read about all the different reincarnations of the Joker, and the pressure that comes with trying to reinvent a character that we all know and have our own opinions of, it must be so much. But you, I guess, in this instance, had a kind of a blank canvas to work with.
Yeah, it's magic. Magic. I mean, I've been, you know, people have suggested Lex Luthor for me in the past, and Doctor Doom and various other things, but yeah, people have done them before, so you'd always have to bear that in mind. But you do that in the theatre, you know, you play Shakespeare parts, they'll have been done before, so that's not a problem. But it's just magnificent being able to create a guy from scratch and, you know, own Dr. Sivana in his first proper incarnation.
Yeah. I was wondering too about your own kind of knowledge of the kind of this cinematic universe, but also that comic book universe, in the sense that when you sort of star in these movies and you go to places like Comic Con, I guess it's a duty to brush up on your knowledge and know enough that if people ask you questions, you know how they fit into stuff. Is that building on sort of knowledge you already had from your childhood, or have you really had to learn all about DC and Marvel and all the kind of different comic books through your work, through your career?
I had to learn it all, because as a young boy, I didn't really have access to superhero comics. That was a very American thing. I had Beano and Whizzer and Chips. Those were the comics I had. Yeah. I don't know if you know, if you've even heard of those comics.
I know
Beano. Do you? Okay.
But
I took it really seriously. I remember when, for example, we were doing Sinestro, the original artwork for him had him looking very different from how he does in the comics. And I took issue with that and said, no, look, what I really want to try and do with this guy, if you can manifest the look of that guy, you know, the big red head, the sort of widow's peak, the moustache, if we can really create that guy in 3D, that's what I'm interested in doing. And they did a fantastic job in the end, but the original artwork wasn't that. And partly the reason I asked for that was because I'm aware that, you know, people really know their stuff, and the fans are really deeply into a lot of these stories and characters, and if we're not delivering stuff that's going to make them happy, then who's going to buy a ticket? Besides which, I also found the more I got into it, the more interesting it is, because these are our amazing stories, and they are incredibly inventive characters. And Shazam is just like the peak of that. You've now got somebody subverting the whole genre by looking at the idea of what do you do if a 14-year-old has all these powers. So, yeah, I've over the years, I've got to know my stuff.
So at what stage did you guys decide not to include kind of Black Adam in this one and instead give that character its own sort of stand alone?
They'd already been separated by the time we each got involved in this. So it was, the idea was, you know, Shazam really merited his own standalone origin story. So when we got involved, that was the mandate.
But you think we can expect to see their paths cross one
day soon? One would hope so. I mean, he's a legendary adversary. So you'd think somewhere down the road that could happen.
And my very final question was about Zach. I mean, I can imagine, I think I was reading that you sort of said hundreds of people were up for this role. I've just met him and I sort of sat in front of him and it was like meeting Shazam. You know, he instantly has that kind of
that
playful
guy.
Energy. So, because I mean, it would have been very easy to give this role to someone with, I don't know, someone slightly more famous, for use of a better word.
Sure.
But so what was it about him? Was it literally that kind of atmosphere he gave off in his personality that made you feel he was right?
It is that he is a big child. And that, you know, seeing his audition made us realize that, oh, that's what being a child is about. Like, it is that, it's not about being, you know, less intelligent than an adult. It's about that enthusiasm, that excitement about the world and the possibilities of the world. And, you know, and that's crucial for this character.
And he is essentially this character because he's got that childlike enthusiasm and all, but he's also a great physical presence. He's a big dude. And so he really is a worthy adversary no matter who you throw at him.
Brilliant. Well, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you. Appreciate it. I'm so glad you enjoyed it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Hey You Guys.
Hey You Guys, huh?
Hey You Guys.
Is that from The Goonies?
It is indeed, yes.
Nice.
Hey You